Hi, welcome back. In this part, I want to discuss the duvet. Now we have the fitted sheet. We need something to go on top of it. So, I've got a quick image here. It's just a viewport capture from something I made earlier. And we're going to make this kind of duvet with double-sided material. It's going to be folded back a little, and it's going to have this kind of interesting pattern on it. So, none of this is particularly difficult to do, but it does require a few steps. The first of which will start in Maya. Now, because we're going to want to simulate on top of this fitted sheet, it's far too many polygons. If we try and simulate on top of this, it's going to take ages. So I'm just going to reduce the geometry of this, which I can do inside Maya. I'm going to Control D to duplicate it first, because I want a copy for rendering, and I'm going to Control H to hide that copy. So I can concentrate on this one. Now I'm just going to go to Mesh Reduce. And I don't know why Maya does that, but it seems to disappear whenever it does. So that'll take it a second or two. And once again, Mesh Reduce. It's still too high. Could go into the options and tell it to do a larger reduction all in one go, but I find several smaller reductions sometimes gives a better result. There we go. And once again, Mesh Reduce. And I have no idea why Maya feels the need to disappear while it does that. But there we go. So now we have a nice reduced mesh for this. And it's important to get rid of the history, because all these mesh reductions will be applied every time I try. If I say try and move this geometry, it can sometimes become incredibly slow with all this on it, especially when I open the scene. It will actually do these reductions on this piece of cloth every time the scene is opened, so it will slow everything down. Let's just go edit, delete by type history to get that off. And nothing on the bed, no history on the bed, so now we can just export these. So just export selection, and we're going to export again as an OBJ for Marvelous Designer. So I'm going to go to the data directory. And I've actually got a bed with mattress export that I did earlier, so I'm just going to save over that. All right, and I'm going to go to Marvelous Designer and just load that in as an OBJ. Remember, set the scale to centimeters. Okay, so there is our kind of proxy object bed, so for modeling this duvet on. And we'll get in there and we'll just create a sheet-like thing. We'll synchronize it across the viewport so we can check out its size. Okay, so it appears to be long enough on the sides, but we can't have it bisecting the bed frame, before we start the simulation, because that's just not going to work. It will just then catch on here and it just won't look very good. So I can tell now that this is going to be too long because it is bisecting here. So I can come up and use the transform and just scale it back a bit, just so it's not touching. There we go. All right, and it's also possible to move this mid-simulation, which I'll give you a quick demo of now. If I turn the particle distance to 40, because we're just doing some tests and it will be a lot quicker, and hit simulate, you'll see that drapes over the bed nicely, and I can actually click on it and pick it up. So if I wanted to fold it back, I can actually move it about while it's simulating, which is a very nice, very handy feature of Marvelous Designer. Now we've got a very low simulation quality on here, which is why we're getting all these jagged edges and whatnot, and this bisection, but we'll take care of that later when we increase the quality. So if you just wanted to do a folded over messy sheet, you can kind of come in like so. And if you want to pull the whole thing back now, you can just start pulling. Or you could also use what's called pins in Marvelous Designer. So if I just stop the simulation and go to this pin tool, I can kind of put a selection of pins across here. I can then simulate and I can grab just those pins. Okay, so this becomes a very cool sort of tool for moving large pieces of cloth around, and also for pinning cloth to avatars. If I was to say, take all this and pin it here, regardless of how I tried to move this around now, this cloth is going to stay pinned there to that bed. I can't actually, pull it out of the way. If you look here, see, it's pinned. It won't move. So pinning's quite an important technique in Marvelous Designer. Just so you know, it definitely a great help for moving stuff around. Like if I wanted to pull this whole bottom across now, I can actually use the pin tool in the pattern view as well to get an exact sort of pin of these bottom bits here. I could lift that right up, pull it out, remove the pins. So very nice, very important for cloth placement pinning. And you can always just go back to the old standby and start picking the cloth up and moving it about to get the look that you want. So this is one of the reasons I like to use Marvelous Designer for this sort of stuff. It's very interactive, it's very fast, unlike Endcloth, which you could use for this, but is quite slow in comparison and not nearly so interactive or user-friendly. So there we go. I mean, if you just wanted a messy top sheet, it's very quick at that. And when you increase the particle density, so sorry, decrease. So if we decrease to 20, you'll see a lot of this clipping that's occurring here will actually just go away. Okay, and if you've got some large areas like this, a neat trick is to stop the simulation, lift the cloth up ever so slightly, and just let it simulate again. So now it will drop down at a higher particle density and it won't bisect. Okay, but for us, we want to do a duvet, not a sheet. I just wanted to show you some techniques for moving cloth about. So let's go back to our rearranged pattern. Okay, and it hasn't quite got that right, so let's put it back in place. So in order to give our duvet some weight, we're going to need a top and a bottom to it. So this is fine as a sheet, but it's got no heft. We need, a puffed up duvet. So I'm going to make a copy of this. I'm going to Control C and Control V, which will just let me paste this pattern over, and you'll see I get another one. Now I'm going to flip this over because you'll see, whoops, in Marvelous Designer, let me just check the gizmo here. So it's just playing silly buggers. In Marvelous Designer, there is a top and a bottom to these things. So this one will be bright white. If I flip it over, you'll see this one is now dark gray. And again, flip it. So top, bottom. Hang on, gizmo's gone wild again. So what I want is a top and a bottom. Okay, so I'm going to connect these two things together like so. All right, so basically the bottom of this one is going to be facing the bottom of this one. The top side is facing outwards and the top side is facing outwards. This will be important for us in a little while. And let's just get this into position so it's not bisecting anything. And this one still seems to have a bit of bisection. Okay, and now we need to sew the top and bottom half of our duvet together. So if we come in and we look at the sides here, I'm going to have to sew this edge here to this edge here, this edge here to this edge here, of course, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to have to do this in the pattern view. And if you want to see what's connected to what or what you will need to sew to what, I can click on this edge here and it shows me it's this edge. And then I'll click on this edge here and it shows me it's this edge. So I take the sewing tool, click here, and again here. And you'll see I've sewed that together, but it's cross-stitched. So if we just undo that, I'll show you why that's happened. So you'll see when I put the sewing tool here, I get a straight line marker. If I move it downwards, the straight line marker changes. So if I put one there and one straight line marker there, and it's crossed over, which it is in this case, I'll have to cross the stitch over. So one here, and make sure this one is here instead of here, here. Okay, and now the stitch is straight. We'll do quite a bit of stitching, so this will become sort of intuitive for you. And again, let's just check where these edges are. This is that top edge, and this edge down here. So we'll need to sew here to here. And again, our stitch is crossed over. So here and here. Okay, our stitch is now straight. And we'll check out where these edges are. So it's this one and this one. Okay, and then these ones have to be this one and this one. And I've crossed that stitch again. This is becoming a little bit more difficult to say how to get a straight stitch because we got one piece facing the opposite way, but you know, not too much of a pain. You can just Control Z undo and cross the stitch. All right, so now if I hit simulate, this will sew itself together. So let me just check. I've got the particle distance on these to 40 and 40, so we can do some tests again. And go, and you'll see they sew together. The problem is they might sew together, but when they hit the bed here, you're still going to see that they look like one very flat sheet. And we need that poofy kind of duvet. So, you know, even though we've sewn two bits of cloth together, that doesn't automatically make them a sort of a thick duvet. What we need to do is select both of our pieces of cloth and then give them some pressure. So if we give them a pressure of, say, 5, you should see this puff up now. Okay, you can see it's starting to inflate, which will give us the look of sort of a puffed up duvet. Now, it might take a second or two to simulate as it comes along here. And you know, we might have to tweak the pressure values depending on how poofy you want your duvet. I mean, that's probably a bit much, really. Someone's ordered the extra large padded duvet there. So if we just grab pressure, and you can do this while it's simulating, and just plonk it down to say 2. And you'll see that falls off quite a bit. All right, so you can experiment with exactly how thick you want your duvet. And one of the things I have noticed is, you know, my duvet is a bit short on the sides maybe, but you know, it's looking pretty good. And I want to fold it over a little bit. So I want to grab it at this corner here, pull it up, and just kind of fold it over. Now, this can be a bit tricky to get right. So, you know, you might have to play around. And it also, how smooth this is, how well this works, and whatnot, will really depend on the speed of your machine here. The machine I'm using is really just not that speedy. So I'm getting this artifacting, and you know, it becomes quite difficult. If you're using a Core i7 of, you know, or a workstation with a couple in maybe, then you're going to find this no problem. If you're using sort of your home PC, then this might take a few tries. But that's kind of folded over enough for me. You know, for the final product, I'll probably spend a bit of time just doing this. Just grabbing the cloth here and neatly folding it out. Whoops. There we go. And you know, I'm just getting this just a bit folded over, like somebody made the bed in a rush in my case. Okay, sometimes it's better not to try and, you know, do it all at once. It's better to just give it a little tug here. Okay, so that'll be folded over neatly enough for me. I want it a bit messy. I mean, it would seem a shame to have a fantastic cloth simulation program and then get a perfectly flat piece of cloth. You know, kind of self-defeating, really. Now I'm going to pin the back just along the edge there, and I'm going to use this pinning to pull the whole duvet backwards a little bit. So you can do this when it's simulating or when it's not. So now it will pull backwards. Then I can just grab it here and just pull it backwards. You know, not too far. I want some wrinkles and whatnot left. So I'm going to stop that simulation process now. And I'm just going to hit remove pin. And then I'll simulate just to let it settle. But what I'll probably do at this point is increase the particle density a bit. Because I'm not going to be, you know, pulling this around by hand anymore. You know, I'm going to drop down this particle density, which will give me a better simulation. But I will warn you, unless you're using a fantastic piece of machinery, I wouldn't try and, you know, pull around cloth like we just did at a particle density of 20 or lower. It's just going to be too slow. So I'll just let the simulation kind of simmer down a bit at this lower density. Okay. And that's looking pretty good so far. It's caught nicely on our four poster here. It's a little bit poofy, as the duvets would be. Probably not enough though. But again, it's not really an issue. I can come up and increase the pressure to say 3, and let's just make sure that got both. Okay. And you should start to see it inflate a little bit. Might take a second or two. No, let's try for a bit more pressure. Let's try 6. Okay, it looks like 6 is going to be way too much. So it can be a bit tricky to dial in the right setting. It's all dependent on what particle distance you're at, what sort of cloth type you've got, and how large of a surface area your cloth has. Okay, but 4 seems to be a pretty good measure for me. I quite like that. Sort of a nice thin duvet. Okay, so that's got our duvet. Now, if we look at the reference shot, you'll see that it's got this pattern on it, which I want to get to, but I'll cover that in the next part. I want to kind of keep these parts short and sweet. Now, to get a double-sided material, especially when we export, what we can do is we can come here like so. And if I look under fabric, I've got this basic fabric here. Well, for a start, I want my duvet to be cotton. So I'm going to create a material and call it top cotton. And I'm going to create another material and call it bottom cotton. Now, these materials not only will affect the color, they'll also affect the simulation properties. So, you're going to get more wrinkles in something like silk than maybe denim or leather. And we'll cover different materials. So let's look at the top, and let's make the color of the top slightly different. It doesn't really matter. And let's assign this to the top material. So I'm just going to drag it on, and that's actually the bottom. Let's drag it on, and let's drag the bottom onto the bottom one. And I'm literally just left mouse dragging those on. So, okay, now we have a top and bottom material. So I can make this bottom color. In fact, I think I'll leave it that color. Now, one of the reasons we did this, and let's give them a cotton preset as well. So we go down to the presets. I'll go chiffon cotton. There we go. And cotton. One of the reasons we did this for different colors in Marvelous Designer is because now when we export this pattern back to Maya, it will come into Maya with 2 different materials on. So we can then use that to assign our own materials to, whether it be Mental Ray, V-Ray, whatever you might be using. Okay, so now this is cotton. Let's simulate it out for a few seconds. You can see I immediately start to get more detailed creases because cotton's a kind of a lighter material than the basic fabric, so it gives nicer creases and whatnot. So cotton, pretty good starting point for materials within Marvelous Designer. Okay. Now, I could export this out. This is pretty good already. If I was doing a render of a bed, this is, not bad at all. In fact, let's export that out to Maya and take a look. Let's just call this Marvelous Designer Duvet Centimeters. Okay. And import. And Marvelous Designer Duvet, there we go. And there you go, we've got those materials in, as I said, from Marvelous Designer. And you can see we've got a little bit of bisection with our avatar object here, or in Maya, our bed. But we can clean that up really easily again with the Sculpt Geometry tool. So if we just go to the Sculpt Geometry tool, and maybe we'll get a bit of a smaller brush, so hold B. And we're probably going to want to smooth that out. Let's look at the settings here and let's pull it out. There we go. I just sort of pull that off. This can sometimes be a better technique than playing around in Marvelous Designer with, really low particle distances, which will give you really, really high poly counts. So it depends again on how you want to do it, but this is a nice simple way to come in and sort of clean all that up. Okay, and actually, even at a particle distance of 20, it's, pretty easy to clean up. Okay, you could then use Soup to do a bit of smoothing. And what we've got there is a pretty nice looking duvet for the top of our bed. We're going to make it a bit better with that pattern, but I'm going to leave that there, and I'll see you in the next part. Thank you very much for watching.